Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
God, just thank you that all that you do for us and how you bless us. And God, be with us tonight as we go through and do the county's business and let us make the decisions that are best for our county. And just be with all those out there that are hurting today and look over them. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Please stand for the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
One public speaker that signed up tonight, Mr. Tony Cox.
You know, I spoke about that many times before, trying to get a little bit more time. I know that the people are set aside 30 minutes, and I could run my mouth for 30 minutes. I know I could. Because a lot of people talk to me about a lot of different things that they wouldn't mind me coming before government and mentioning about it, whether it's with the schools, ACC, there's just a lot of things. And I'm not just a dumb old plumber. I'm a fixer. You know, NASCAR, they made a huge mistake with Kurt Busch. Somebody said that Kurt Busch done something wrong, and they run out there and they done all these things, and this special person over here, here's what it is. They stopped Kurt Busch from running in the Daytona 500. He'll never get that back. Never. He will never get that. But now NASCAR, they're, oh, we're sorry. And if it gets down to the points towards the end, we'll fix it. You will be in the championship this year. A lot of things, people do a lot of things. See, that's like back in 2006. We had to have that Alamance County High Impact Land Use and Polluting Industries Ordinance because of an asphalt plant toll. Thursday night at the planning board, here comes a speedway, and I find out that a speedway from 2006 through to date, to my knowledge, has never been permitted under the Alamance County High Impact Land Use and Polluting Industries Ordinance. There's been a few complaints out there, and this ain't about a speedway. I could care less about a speedway. They got their own thing. They got special privilege. But I guess Kurt Busch will get his. And one of these days, according to the law, I'm going to get mine. Mr. Engel, I'm going to ask you, how many times in your career as a law enforcer have you ever charged somebody with a Class 3 misdemeanor or above and didn't go before a magistrate and swear to it?
Well, Mr. Cox, you're speaking now, sir.
Okay.
Respond to that.
All right. But, see, there's one thing I know. I know a lot about the law. There's people that know me since Main Street, let's say. And if you think back to them days whenever I got arrested for being a dumb kid back then, I wonder how many times I really broke the law versus made somebody mad. Because I'm good at making people mad. I'm real good at it. Mr. Smith did that. Boy, if he was a judge, I'd have been in jail for contempt, wouldn't have been spent. But I love him. Hey, that man right there, if I need help, he'll help me, and I'll help him more, Mr. Smith.
Yeah.
I'll help Mr. Smith.
Thank you. Thank you, Tony. Appreciate it. Any commissioner's responses?
Well, I don't think, right now is probably not the time, but I'd like Libby to report to us a little later on the racetrack and that issue. They did deal with that at the planning board last week. So I don't know if you'd rather do it now or at the end of the...
Libby, would you like to give a brief comment about where you're at while we're in commissioner's comments and questions made?
No problem. At this week's past planning board meeting, we basically got together the new management for the Speedway and the homeowners that were concerned about the noise at the Speedway, and they discussed it and decided not to take any other action at this time, to let them give the new management a chance to make sure that what they're going to do is in the spirit of the noise ordinance.
Thank you, Libby. Thank you. Appreciate it. All right. Approval of the agenda. Before I receive a motion, there's an amendment. Departmental spotlight was erroneously left off the agenda for the night. It is the library, and I'd like to amend the agenda to just add a brief presentation by Mrs. Wilkerson and her staff, and she's grinning, so that it'll be brief. I know she. Thank you, ma'am. And so, with that being said, do I have a motion approval of the agenda as amended?
So moved.
Second.
Ms. Burns, second. Vice Chair, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you. All right, moving on to our consent agenda. Members, are there any items that to be withheld from our consent agenda tonight?
No.
Having heard none, do I have a motion on approval of the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Ms. Massey, second by our Vice Chair. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. All right, presentations and other business. Moving on, item 7-1, request to set a public hearing for economic development incentives. Mr. Mike Williams, Chamber President. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. I'm here tonight to ask you to set a date for a public hearing to consider our request for economic development incentives for a new company that will be establishing a presence in Alamance County, should everything unfold as we hope it will. The company name is CBC America, which was the name of the group. And with that, I will leave it to you folks to set the date. The requested date would be your next meeting, which is April the 6th. And at the same time, they would also be approaching the city of Mebane as well on April 6th.
Is there any problem with that as far as staff getting what you need to cover?
No, sir. We've been working with the chamber on this, and what we're looking at is incentivizing based upon jobs. There's 29 jobs that we're looking at $500 per job. So it'd be $14,500. But the investment that they're looking at is over $2.8 million.
Move approval.
Second on that.
All right, a motion from the judge, second by Vice Chair, that we set a public hearing on this economic development incentive issue for April the 6th. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you. See you in April.
Yes, sir. See you in April. All right, item number 2 of 7, 1329, resolution of support for EMT immunity bill. Mr. Albright, our county attorney.
Good evening.
Good evening.
This resolution in support of this bill would, if the bill is passed into law, would provide the emergency medical technicians, responders, and dispatchers with the same immunity that the sheriff's deputies have. And I think it was overlooked during the tort reform law that was amended. And our representative Riddell is pushing this through the legislature. We hope that it's going to be approved, and I'd ask the board to approve the resolution supporting it.
All right, sir. Any questions?
I just have a question. Is the Association of County Commissioners, did they take a stand on this issue?
We have asked them to do that, and for the last 3 years, we've been trying to get this immunity passed. They have not, to my knowledge, gotten behind this bill, but the Emergency Medical Association has. And the Court of Appeals has just come down with a recent decision that says that volunteer firemen that are acting in the capacity of emergency medical technician have immunity. So it seems like a natural step to just go ahead and make it.
Now, these staff aren't volunteers, though. These are paid and trained and
right.
Credentialed. And so and I'm not saying I'm going to vote against this. I think I'm in favor of this. But just to be sure that in the event there's an incompetent person that happens, I know it's unlikely, but just hypothetically, if somebody that was incompetent got on our staff and did something that generated a lawsuit, that's going to come to the county, not to the individuals.
That's correct.
So people still have a recourse or something like that.
Right, the county.
That was my main concern.
That would come to the county instead of that individual is what that would do.
But in the Court of Appeals decision, what I couldn't understand was if a volunteer fireman driving a red truck provides you emergency medical services, he has immunity according to the Court of Appeals, but someone that's trained driving in an ambulance does not.
Which a lot of times that guy.
Which is odd.
And the fire truck's the first one on the scene to start administering emergency care.
And our folks are well trained and they don't do this for the money, they do it because they want to help people.
Move approval.
All right, Judge has made a motion. I will say that there is a keen interest in the General Assembly for this bill as well as our first bill that Representative Rydell. As a matter of fact, I think there's 12 different folks signed up for that just wanting to bring a little bit. Oh, yeah, sign on to, not this one, but the,
right, the food first one.
The food bill. And it's kind of gained its own, identity. They change as they go through committees down there, and sometimes what you ask for and then what you receive at the end are two different animals. So we're just hopeful that it maintains course. But we do have a motion to approve this resolution. Do I hear a second? Second by the Vice Chair. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. All right, that's all right.
And your comment about two different animals is a great segue.
That gets you into the fox.
Yes, Mr. McCandless, I don't know if he's here tonight or not. I don't think he is. He had called. He is trying to get a fox den set up in Alamance County so he can train foxhounds. And the law regarding foxes is very strange. Varies from county to county, and sometimes from the northern part of the county to the southern part of a county. But the local wildlife enforcement folks have suggested that this resolution you have before you would be helpful. Because in 1979, our legislature, in their wisdom at that time, made it illegal to chase foxes with dogs. Now, the result of that was that people that trained foxhounds brought in coyotes.
Yeah.
And coyotes are smarter than foxes, and they have overrun our state. But you can, in 1989, the General Assembly passed a law that said you can shoot them, and you can track them. But this law that you can't chase them with dogs is still on the books.
Yeah.
Mr. McCandless has indicated that he is going to muzzle these dogs so they don't injure the fox when they do catch it. So the fox won't be hurt. But the dogs get trained. So it'll bring some jobs into the community, and he's excited about it. And the wildlife enforcement people are behind him on this thing. And they'd like a resolution in support, and that's what you have before you tonight.
For further information, this is an impoundment in the north central part of county that consists of 21 acres of high fence. In other words, and we're the North Carolina Wildlife Association issues a license for the coyote that's in the impoundment. They oversee the feeding. They make sure that the coyote is not only fed, but they have to provide dens in that training facility. We have these in Caswell County and also in the eastern part of the state already. The only reason that the gentleman that applied for this petition for this with us couldn't do it in the northern part of the county is because of the local ordinance on running dogs in the northern part of the county.
Pertains to the northern part of the county?
Yes. So once we approve allowing that, then he's still got to go before the North Carolina Wildlife Resources Commission to get approval and make sure that he's under the regulations to keep that open, so that's where we're at. Any further comments or questions?
No, just to point out the fact that dogs will be muzzled while they're chasing the fox.
they'll be muzzled, and I think the regulations even require them. They can't even do it like 2 or 3 months here during this time of year, a little later, because what are the wildlife? What are they doing now? They're having little ones.
Yes. Yeah.
So they can't even do it when even coyotes that are not protected in North Carolina, they, you know, they still they're safer in there than they are outside there, because if they go after my dogs, I'm going to shoot them. All right, with that being said, any further comments from the commissioners?
So moved.
All right, Judge has made a motion that for approval. Do I have a second? I'll second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Salt. All right, moving on to capital reserve fund request, our assistant county manager, Mr. Brian Haygood.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Commissioners. I'm here this evening with a request that the board approve the county spending $77,875 from the county's Capital Buildings Capital Reserve Fund. These monies will be used for repairs to the heat and air system for the second floor here in the county office building. The heat and air system on this floor is original. It's in poor shape. These funds would be used to replace the controls, air handlers, valves, and fans. All these items need to be replaced for the system to work properly. We've been working with Hoffman Building Technologies. They will oversee the project. They've done work for us before. They did a project at the Criminal Courts Building, did a very good job. Hoffman will supply the replacement equipment. This job would also require electrical and plumbing work, and that has been bid out and awarded. Quality Mechanical will do the plumbing work, and Control Systems Corporation will do the electrical work. The current balance of the Capital Reserve Fund is different than what you have in your packet. The current balance is $103,205.62. I apologize, the information I put in your packet reflected the World Trade Center dollars coming from Capital Reserve.
Right.
So the true balance is $103,205.62. If the board approves this project, the remaining balance in the Capital Reserve Fund will be $25,330.62. Richard Hill of County Maintenance here with us, and also Tim Sanders of Hoffman, if you have any questions about the project.
Is this our most pressing issue?
The one that we can afford, yes.
You want to tell us something else?
We have a number of issues. We're working to bring you a list, but the balance is only $100,000, so we can afford this one. It is a repair to a building that we plan to keep, plan to operate for a long period of time, believe it would be a wise investment, but there are other needs.
Is it my understanding this is the original unit to this building?
This building and the building next door actually share a boiler, chiller, and main distribution of power. So we're talking about original equipment from back in the 60s and 70s.
That's my next question, the age of this building, so it's the 60s.
Yeah, what's happened, Commissioners, is that the pneumatics have gone out of the building. The lines were plugged. We can't get actuators to work. So what we're talking about doing is getting rid of the pneumatic controls and go with an electric control. Mm-hmm. And we're actually using Hoffman's allergen system, which we've already purchased for the Criminal Courts Building. We're just going to piggyback right on that, no additional cost. So the money we're spending is plumbing, getting the reheat coils operational, and actually allow us to manipulate airflow and condition of air from one department to the other. A lot of the departments on this floor share the same air handler. So when you make a change in one department, it affects another. So it's an age issue.
So what's the time frame?
Let's not get into age.
What will be the time frame of this project?
Upon approval, I don't know, Tim, if you want to speak to that. How
it would take probably 45 days for engineering process, and we could probably, I'd say, after that, be on site. We could do some of the work while the electronic engineering is going on, such as replacing the valves and things like that. You know, those things could happen.
The price in front of you assumes all overtime work, so as not to affect the county
so function. So that was another question I was going to ask.
Nights, as we can do some of that, and the departments have shown a lot of flexibility, that price will probably come down.
Okay, so that has been figured in on overtime pay for your employees.
Yes, sir.
Move approval, Mr. Chairman.
Judge has moved for approval. Do I have a second?
I'll second it.
Move a second. All those in favor?
Go home.
See if I'm saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Brian. All right, North Carolina Association of County Commissioners Legislative Update Video.
this is the video we were to look at last month, so. Oh, it's a new video, it's an updated video, so I apologize, so.
We'd like to welcome you to the NCACC update for March 2015. In today's program, we'll give you a look at our NCACC district meeting schedule. We'll tell you about the highlights of the NACO Legislative Conference in Washington, D.C. And we'll tell you about an upcoming opportunity to add your input to the NCACC strategic plan. Remember that you can always find more information about any of the items highlighted in this video by visiting www.ncacc.org. or by following us at any of the various social media sites you see on your screen. First, let's talk about the upcoming input sessions for the strategic plan. The NCACC is exploring trends and challenges affecting counties in order to assess our capabilities and define our mission for the next decade. We began implementation of our first strategic plan 10 years ago. That plan has guided every initiative we have undertaken since then. As we embark on a new decade of executive leadership, we are interested in thoroughly understanding the world in which you govern. We are consulting our members to get observations about the future of county government in North Carolina, and your input is essential. Our goal is to help strengthen county government by positioning the association to help you meet the identified challenges and trends. Please participate in our visioning process by contributing your thoughts and ideas at one of our upcoming regional input sessions. As a token of appreciation for your participation, we will provide a complimentary lunch or dinner. No advance preparation is needed, just register for the session you plan to attend. Please do not hesitate to contact Patrice Rosler, NCACC Deputy Director, at the number or email you see on the screen should you have any questions. Many thanks in advance for participating in this important process. We sincerely appreciate your suggestions about how NCACC can further its mission of service to counties. In mid-February, each county was mailed an information packet filled with all the materials needed to host a meeting for your state legislative delegation. We are asking that each county schedule a meeting with its legislative delegation before the NCACC district meetings in April to discuss these county concerns and to gather feedback from your legislators. Speaking of the district meetings, each spring the NCACC hosts a series of district meetings throughout the state. The meetings offer county commissioners and management staff an opportunity to learn about legislative developments in Raleigh, to share information from their conversations with legislators, to network with officials from other counties, and to learn about the NCACC programs and services that benefit counties. There is no cost to attend the meetings, which begin at 5:30 p.m. and include dinner. Each meeting will conclude by 8 p.m. 2015 district meetings will be held at the locations you see on your screen. The reason there is no registration fee is thanks to the generosity of our sponsors, but you must register in advance so that they will have an accurate count for meals. After district meetings conclude, the NCACC will host its 2015 County Assembly Day on Wednesday, May 6, 2015, at the Quorum Center here in Raleigh. County Assembly Day is an opportunity for North Carolina county officials to meet with and hear from state legislative leaders and meet with their legislative representatives. The event begins in the morning with a legislative update from NCACC staff and remarks from leaders of the General Assembly. After lunch, attendees visit the North Carolina General Assembly to meet with members of their delegation. In February, more than 150 North Carolina county officials attended the NACO Legislative Conference in Washington, D.C. to learn about the federal issues and to lobby their federal delegation about issues of importance to counties. The event culminated with the NCACC's annual congressional breakfast, which was attended by 11 of the 15 members of the state's congressional delegation. Several members of the delegation pledged to work with counties on all 11 of the federal priorities adopted by the NCACC Board of Directors. North Carolina was well represented during the NACO conference. Orange County Commissioner Renee Price moderated one workshop and was a panelist in another session, both on topics related to economic development. NCACC Executive Director Kevin Leonard moderated a session on tips for effective advocacy at the grassroots level, and Public Relations Director Todd McGee moderated a session on developing a county communications plan. Thanks again for joining us for this NCACC update. Please visit www.ncacc.org for more information on the items we discussed here.
And as always, feel free to contact us with questions via phone or email. Thanks again.
All right. Thank you. Any comments from commissioners? Or Mr. Honeycutt?
No comments on that. I guess they're going to be doing that as a monthly video during the long session. So this is, we'll bring popcorn next time.
All right. Thank you, sir. Moving on to item that was added to the agenda, item number six, Department Spotlight or Library. Brief presentation, Ms. Wilkerson, the staff.
And I promise I'll be brief.
Thank you.
I did bring, because I know this wasn't on the agenda, this is copies of the slides that you're going to see. So everybody knows that the library checks out books and movies and DVDs and this type of thing, but we are about so much more than that. And as we look into the future and the role of libraries, my staff is looking at what role we want to play in our community. And what we keep going back to are access, literacy, and enrichment. And so access covers a lot of ground. We provide access to materials to people that can't even walk through our doors. We have ebooks. We just started electronic magazines. We have an outreach program that has just boomed in the last several years. In December of 2013, we only circulated 152 items to homebound people. And in December of 2014, we were circulating 492 items to homebound people. These are people that for whatever reason cannot leave their house, whether it's a permanent situation or a temporary situation. And our outreach person, coordinator, has really worked on getting this program up and running. And as all of us baby boomers keep aging, there are more and more people that are homebound and need the home services. So our outreach circulation has increased. The number of patrons that we serve through our outreach program has increased. So outreach is one of many other services that we offer. We, as I said, we circulate books and DVDs. We also circulate the electronic materials. We circulate electronic magazines, playaways, all kinds of things. In our circulation, this past 8 months, we've circulated 513 items, a little over 513 items. Our programs, we've really concentrated on a lot of the programs that we offer. 72% of them are children's programs. The 3% were for teens and 25% were for adults. And so 883 programs were offered and over 21,000 people attended them. We're really looking at how we do our programs and what kind of programs we offer, because we want those programs to be more interactive and make a difference. So it's less about entertainment and more about making people's lives better, providing literacy skills, whether it's financial literacy, digital literacy, school readiness literacy, adult literacy. So we're really looking at our programs making a difference in people's lives instead of just being pure entertainment value. Over 300,000 people have already come through our doors. We serve a broad range of people. I was reading in the Burlington Times News actually about the Sunshine and access to information, and this is Sunshine Week for public information. A lot of people in our community don't have the internet connections or the computers or access to that information, and it's the library is where they go to get that information. And we provide not only information, but we help people distinguish what's accurate, good information versus what's, you know, from the National Enquirer kind of information. So all the people that walk through our doors come from all walks of life, whether they have a lot of money and they're just reading books for entertainment value or for whatever reason, or they don't have any money and they don't have access to computers or the internet. So we serve a lot of people. Over 88,000 computer sessions. Our computers are in use constantly. You have to make an appointment to sign up to get an hour on the computer. So they're huge. If you'll see the little picture in the corner that says Newland Night, we just had Newland School's first night at the library. We had over 220 students and parents at May Memorial last Thursday night. And this was a program from one of our low-performing schools. Transportation was not provided for the families, but we worked with the school to have the program to get them excited about reading. Our mascot, Leo, went into the school system and got all the kids excited about coming to the library. The parents came, the teachers, the principal, and the tutors served supper in our meeting room, so they had something to eat. We had tours of the libraries. We gave every service desk was offering library cards, you know, getting people to get signed up for library cards, explaining about all the services. It was a hop in place, and we thought maybe we'd have 50, maybe 75, over 220. It was amazing. And if we get these people excited about reading and this community of our citizens excited about reading, then we're really making an impact in people's lives. And then we partner with our community. We have partnered so far with over 105 agencies and businesses in our community. We have we work with YMCA to do Zumba and fitness classes. We are working with Alamance Community College. We have to offer GED classes at Graham and adult literacy classes. We're working with the Burlington Royals to work together on a summer reading program. We've got the Elon Service Learning helping us out with some projects. So we're really getting the word out that we are about our community and we are more than our four walls, you know, the bricks and mortar, that we want to be involved in every aspect of our community, and the library is an essential part of what we do. So that's just a very quick, brief rundown. I promised I would be quick. Just to help people know that we do more than check out books, and we do a lot of different things.
Thank you, Ms. Whipson. Any comments?
Are you tracking the GED program that of the people coming in?
We are tracking that.
Yeah, ACC has to.
Okay. Okay, because I think that is a good service for the people. A lot of them can't get to the community college and stuff.
And that's why we're doing that at Graham. Eventually, we want to expand that to our other branches. Graham is a good central location.
Right.
So we started there. We have seven people, I believe, that are involved in that. And it's already making a huge difference
good.
In those seven people's lives.
Well, I'd like to say that, you know, education, in my view, is one of the most important things for our community. And I see what you do. Complimenting what ABSS does. We have Pam Thompson, the chairperson of the school board, and
yeah.
Tony Rose on the school board here tonight, and also complimenting what's done at ACC. So
yes.
I think it's great.
And we really are looking at our role in the community and looking at ourselves as a supplement to the schools, all the different schools, whether it's the school system, Elon, Alamance Community College.
Thank you, MJ.
Thank you. Well, appreciate it. All right, next we have the county manager's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah.
Do have a couple things that need to talk to you. I hope you have your calendars as well. We do have some dates that we do need to discuss. First thing I did want to talk about was our strategic plan update. We have not forgot about it. Libby has been working with the COG and trying to formulate a proposal They've had some illnesses at the COG, so that's the reason why that's kind of been on a hold, but I think we're moving that forward. Libby, do you want to say?
Just real quickly, I had a probably about half-hour conversation today with Lydian Altman at the School of Government, and she had some really great ideas. Looking to bring some of that back shortly.
So, but it is not a forgotten item.
Thank you.
So
I noticed that the town of Elon is using the School of Government, I think, and helping them with their plans. So.
Yes, sir. Next, I did want to mention our budget workshops, and this is part of the calendar, making sure we get them out. The week of April 13th through 17th, from 9 till noon, we are looking at our internal departments. We don't have a schedule yet, but that's the time that we're looking at, and we'll be getting with our departments on a more detailed schedule. And then the next week, April 20th through 24th, if you would also schedule from 9 to noon, that's when we will meet with the external departments and agencies that we fund. Any questions or problems with that? We'll try to schedule as many as we can, but and not keep it past the 3-hour time frame. You know, some agencies will get a lot more time than others, such as the school system and ACC. They'll get a lot more time than some that the smaller agencies as well. But we want to make sure that the entire board is part of the process on that. Okay. I do want to give you a quick update on our computer server issues and the issues we've had with our IT. We have hired a consultant, Michael Nelson, who will be meeting with us on Thursday to go over his review of the MIS department after we've interviewed every employee within the department. And we want to see what functions they do, what we can do better, and see if there are things that we can do a little bit different. And hopefully we'll get a final draft from him on Thursday, and we'll be able to have a report to the Board of Commissioners on April 4th. Also, we have been working with Davenport, who does a lot of our backup work, and looking at what we could do now that would help us with our backup so we do not have the issues that we had when the servers went down. So there will be a cost associated. We don't know what at this time, but we are trying to come up with a plan to go ahead and put a better backup system in place than we do have now. If there's any questions, but again, we'll have a more detailed look and report at the April meeting.
Any questions from any of the commissioners?
On the budget hearings, what are your time spans? Because some of us up here have to still work for a little bit.
So I'm sorry.
What's the, you're talking about the budget workshops?
Yes, sir.
And what time are you thinking of doing all those?
In the morning. The workshop's in the morning, then we'll
have... Some of us have to work.
We can work around you.
Okay.
If we need to take a couple of days in the evening, we'll try to do that as well. You tell us, since the rest of the board is a little bit more flexible. But we'll be glad to work with you. Just during that week. We'll be glad to work with you, whatever we can.
All right. Do you anticipate it taking all of this time, those 2 weeks?
No, but wanted to probably not, but we wanted to go ahead and block out the time just to make sure.
Okay.
Make sure that we gave everybody ample opportunity to present their wants and needs to the board before we begin the final compilation of it.
Mayor, are you saying we're going to meet every day for 2 weeks?
That's what I was trying to say.
Right now, we just want you to kind of block off that time in the morning.
You used to do that in one day.
Yeah, they need to condense it a little bit.
Let me clarify this. I think, well, Mr. Hunnigan, what you're saying is, we're going to set this during these 2 weeks. We don't really have the exact times and dates down, but be looking to keep those clear in your calendar.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Again, some departments will take, you know, 15, 20 minutes. Some will be longer. So if the sheriff is here, the sheriff usually takes a day and a half.
I think Judge can have that.
I'm just giving him a hard time.
Can you do something with that?
Take care of that. I'll be your son there, Jay.
But again, we'll work with, but I just want to kind of give you that time frame of what we're looking at. So
thank you, Mr. Hunnigan.
Couple other things as well.
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry. I'm on a roll. I'm on a roll.
Go ahead.
Just wanted to update you that our next facilities meeting with ABSS, with the committee, is scheduled right now for Wednesday, April 1st at 9:30 a.m. at the ABSS library on Vaughn Road. Also, you should have gotten an email that has invited the entire board to participate, if you so choose, in going out and visiting the schools. So I believe the ABSS board, they would like to have their entire board as part of that process, so that they've invited us as well. And the thought process is, not everybody is going to all schools, but we're going to break it up in smaller groups so that all schools are covered. So if you are interested in that, hopefully on the 1st we can finalize that and finalize who will be going with who.
I thought we were going to actually do some of that prior to our next meeting. Am I?
No.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Next.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Ms. Thomas.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
It starts, I'm scheduled
17th through the 19th or
something. The 19th.
19th, okay.
But, yeah.
And what time does that bus leave?
The person that knows about that bus was out sick today. I don't drive that bus. I would drive that bus. Tony Rose can drive that bus. But I'm sure we'll know tomorrow.
Right.
Because a lot of people, you know, require that.
We'll get that scheduled to you as well of when that, and again, I apologize if I got those dates wrong. But the next facilities meeting will be April 1st. Also, wanted to give you a quick update on the 9/11 memorial donations. As you can see there, that is what we have on our website. We have received $120 from the community so far. From the website, and also today we got notification from Rich and Thompson that they will be donating $500 to the 9/11 memorial. And Brian, is it 36?
We're at $3,620 right now from outside sources. That includes cities, businesses, some private individuals that came in directly to the county, not through the website.
So I would like to make a donation of $200.
I'll match it.
Well, okay. I'll match it.
All right, there you go. We got six. We take any more.
That's all right.
I'll do a donation.
Okay.
We thank you.
How do we get to that? Is that linked on the?
Yes, it's on there. You can do it there. I'll bring you a check.
That's what I'll do.
Yeah.
I'll do cash or check.
I can too.
And a couple more dates to remind you. The City County Dinner, our quarterly dinner, is Thursday night at the Mebane's Arts Council at 6 p.m. Or excuse me, Mebane Arts Center at 6 p.m. As I mentioned on the video about a legislative meeting with our delegation, we have that scheduled for a breakfast on March 30th. At 8:30 a.m. Here in the Board of Commissioners room, we'll go over our legislative goals and we can talk a lot about our local bills with our delegation. And also the next day is the Farm Bureau Luncheon, which will be held on March 31st at AO Community Center at 11 a.m. And usually the best steak I eat all year.
Yeah.
Other than the fire department.
It is good, eh?
So, and that's all I have.
All right. Any questions of our county manager before we move on? All right, we come to Commissioner.
Oh, Mr. Chairman.
Yes,
yes. I want to recognize three students in the back.
I was going to ask them who they were before.
Yeah, I'm suspicious over there.
On Wednesday nights, one of the best things that I do is teach state and local government at ACC. And part of their grade this semester was they had to attend a local meeting and kind of write a summary. So I felt like it was important for them to see government firsthand. And we have Terry Hsu, we have Sarah Copley, and we have Crystal Hillman. So
welcome, welcome.
How is he as a teacher? That's my
There is a test next week. Bad for you to say. So we already start with a 12. No, they're really good kids, and really enjoy working with. So.
Again, welcome tonight. All right, is that all, Mr.
Hunter? I'm afraid that's it.
No, all right, thank you, sir. At this time, we'll go to commissioners' comments. Any commissioners have a comment tonight?
I've got one that was sent out by the Association of Commissioners about the sales tax. Can you brief us on the impact of that to the county if legislation pushes through what they're thinking about doing?
And I hope I didn't jump the gun with the board, but there is a discussion in Raleigh right now about reallocating sales tax. It would be based upon population and not where the goods are purchased. Right now, if it's purchased in Alamance County, we get that percent back in Alamance County. And especially for us with Alamance Crossing and Tanger, that's really helped our sales tax base. But if they start doing it proportionately by population, we'll be a giver county and not a receiver.
Yeah.
And so that's not a good thing. I've sent a couple of emails.
Yeah, I saw where Representative Rydell replied that he would not be in favor of that.
Right. So,
didn't we make some investment to be able to have these retail?
I believe Mebane may have put some water in sewer.
We didn't really do it. Retail. Yeah. I'm pretty sure of that. I don't know if this would be proper for us to do, but should we draft a resolution for our representatives for our next meeting?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
If the board's in agreement, I guess.
The consensus of the board is we are in agreement with that. So that'll be fine. Thank you. Any other things, Mr. Vice Chair?
One other thing. Today we met in Mebane with the governor. He came down for the historic tax credits, which he is making his tour of North Carolina, trying to put those back in place. And Bob was there, and it was a good tour of the White Furniture Factory and another building that was actually in Mebane that was an old building that had been made into apartments. Really, really neat stuff going on there with that. And, that's just a comment. That's fine.
Thank you. Bob, Judge? I want to thank our three volunteers that were volunteered that assisted me on the ad hoc committee. Sammy's here tonight. Sammy Moser and Albert Freeman and also John Paisley. And we've had our first meeting. And Pam, we're looking forward to getting to those schools and just seeing what needs to be done. So we're excited about that. And the facilities, and knowledge is wisdom. Again, I say that. And if we can get in there and see what needs to be fixed, it makes all the difference in the world. I know all three of you feel the same way, so we want to do what's right. But thank you. If there's nothing else, meeting's adjourned.
Good night.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the Commissioners' meetings may be made to the Commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.